She may be best known as the former president of Planned Parenthood, but Gloria Feldt is also an activist and an author who teaches women power and politics at Arizona State University. She's out with a new book titled No Excuses, which encourages women to reconsider their ideas about power and leadership. Joining me now is Gloria Feldt, and good to have you here. Thanks. Good to see you again.
It's great to be here, Ted.
This is an interesting book. In that no one is keeping women from, you're saying, no one is keeping women from parity but themselves?
Now, I did just take on the issue of women in the U.S. I should be clear about that, okay, because I found that to be a big enough topic in and of itself. But basically, it's not that there aren't still barriers. There are still external barriers. There still is discrimination in some ways. There still are issues that women have to deal with every day. But the fact is, we've changed the laws. Almost every door has been opened at least once. You know, I mean, when you're confirming the fourth female Supreme Court justice, it's a very different environment than when we were just wishing there could be only one.
So things like the pressure to conform, which has been an issue for women in the past, you're saying maybe still now, but not an excuse.
Exactly. What I say in the book is there are many reasons, and they're valid reasons, but there are no excuses anymore if a woman wants to accomplish something in this world. And one of the things that I talk about is why we need to redefine power in order to do that. Because very often women have really negative thoughts about power for good reason. We've borne the brunt of the bad side of power. We've been discriminated against. We've been the ones who've been beaten or raped or whatever. And if we change our idea about power from a sort of old-fashioned, oppressive, hierarchical model of power over, you know, I have the power over you, to being one where we think of it as being the power to accomplish great things in this world, well, suddenly it just changes everything. And it's less scary for women.
And I want to get to this idea of redefining power and unused power that you write about. But I want to get back to this no excuses thing, because I find that very, very interesting. And there are a lot of issues at work-life balance, just general socialization, these sorts of things. Were these issues in the past and not so much now? Or again, as you said earlier, is it the kind of thing where the hurdle is low enough to where you should be able to get over it?
Well, I am often speaking on a panel with some young women, and they often talk about their pushes and pulls with work-life balance. And my answer to that is always, you know, it's a sign of progress when you get to worry about work-life balance. I just wanted to be allowed to work at a job that didn't say help wanted female. You know, I wanted it to be a job that I wanted to do. So it's a sign of progress. That doesn't mean it's not a real problem. It is a real problem. But it's a new problem. I'd like to tell you about why I started looking at this issue, though. It all started when I was doing an article in 2008 about organizations that help women run for office. And what I found was that they are scarcely moving the dial. And when I looked more deeply into it, I discovered that women can raise money as well as men now. When women run, they are as likely to win as a male candidate. But women are still 17% of Congress. We're less than 25% of state legislatures. We run fewer than 10% of the top 100 cities in this country. So there has to be something else going on. And then I discovered it was the same dynamic in work and in personal relationships. And it really is a sort of resistance to claiming power.
Is it a resistance to claiming power? That sounds like there's a comfort factor there. Are women just, in general, not comfortable with that yet?
Well, again, it sort of depends on the kind of power, because one of the things I discovered was that if you want a woman to run for office, let her want something for her children. You know, Senator Patty Murray, for example, I tell her story of Senator from Washington State. She was concerned about the fact that the legislature was taking funding away from her child's kindergarten. And so she marched down to the state legislature with her children in tow, and she was told by her representative, "You're just a mom in tennis shoes. What do you know?" So she claimed that. She ran as a mom in tennis shoes. She eventually defeated this man. She would have never thought of running for office but she was concerned about her child's school. She wanted her child to have this. And that's what I found over and over. When women can think of it as being the power to get something done, if they see an injustice, then they'll go for it.
Is that the unused power you're talking about?
There's a lot of that is unused power. Some examples, I mean, numbers really tell the story here. For example, women buy 85% of the consumer goods that are sold in this country. Women make up 15% of the boards of directors of the companies that decide what we're going to be sold. Now, to me, that is serious power unused. If we wanted to get together and make a stand about what kind of consumer goods and the quality and perhaps the environmental impact and the health of them, of those products, we could determine the shape of every single consumer product if we would do that. That's power unused.
And that means shifting, changing the ideas, as you did earlier, regarding what power and what leadership really means.
Exactly.
All right. Women still need to get there as far as, you know, the reason you wrote the book is that they're not quite there yet. What about men? How are they going to respond to this?
That's an excellent question. And I think we have a generation of men who've been raised by women who are generally more likely to be in the workforce, who are more likely to have raised them with some more egalitarian notions. And so young men assume that their partners are going to enter the workforce. They actually are glad to be able to share the burden of earning income. What I think needs to happen next is that young women and young men need to join together to really deal with this work-life balance question that you brought up, because the young men would like to be more of a part of their children's lives, just as young women are. And yet the burden of child rearing still falls more heavily on women. So I think they need to join together.
Okay, let's shift it to politics.
Okay.
Got out of that one fast, didn't I?
You did.
Yeah. Let's talk about this particular, the whole dynamic that you're talking about. How does it work in politics? How does it work when you have a progressive woman candidate running against a conservative woman candidate, mm-hmm. and you got all sorts of power there. Some are using it and some aren't.
Right. I think Sarah Palin gave the whole country a little cognitive dissonance because she stood up and she claimed to be a feminist. And in some ways, she is very much in a feminist model. I mean, she was a basketball player thanks to Title IX in high school. They called her Sarah Barracuda. And she embraces much of the whole idea that a woman can be anything she wants to be. Unfortunately, the policies that she espouses would not take women to economic justice or to reproductive rights or to any of the things that have enabled women to actually find their way in the world and to be able to have a life. And so that's what gives people cognitive dissonance.
So when supporters of Sarah Palin or supporters of that particular political viewpoint say that, yeah, but what's wrong with staying home? What's wrong with being a mom? When Gloria Feldt writes these books, she's saying there's something wrong with people that want to stay home and raise a family. How would you respond?
Well, what I would say is that the choices we make in life have consequences, and that's what I want women to understand. It's not that it's wrong. It's that there are consequences. If you stay home and you don't earn a living yourself or you lose your professional skills, if you should need to get back in the workforce, say you get divorced, as 50% of us will, say your husband dies, you know, you're in very difficult circumstances. Or you also need to understand that, you know, that what each of us does actually impacts other women. If I have an MBA and I'm like 50% of the women MBAs right now, and I have a child and I decide I'm going to opt out of the workforce, what that's doing is it's causing the people who do the hiring to think, well, why should I hire a woman? Because she's just going to drop out if she has children. So what I want women to understand is that the decisions that we make are not made in isolation. They really do have consequences for ourselves and for other women, and I believe that until women reach parity, and even after, we have a moral obligation to one another to think proactively about what that means.
But back to our first point, you're saying nothing's keeping women from achieving parity,
yes.
or getting doggone close, mm-hmm. But themselves. That's kind of one minefield there. We just got through the other minefield as far as, you know, those who say that your mindset is not fair to those who say no. What I know you're changing hands now tomorrow night to sign your
book. Yes, I'll be 7 o'clock at Changing Hands tomorrow. I'll be reading and signing, and I'll actually be interviewing a few people who either were in the book or who I talked about in some way.
Well, you'll have a chance to talk to a lot of folks at Changing Hands tomorrow, and I'm wondering what kind of reaction you're expecting there. What kind of reaction have you received so far from this?
You know, I've received a little bit of resistance, and much of it has been the kind of questions that you've asked of me. But one of the things that I have done with No Excuses, and it's very important to me, as I'm just a practical activist. And when I wrote this book, my intent was not to blame. My intent was not to do one of those hand-wringing books that say, oh, isn't it terrible? Women can't, or women shouldn't, or women won't, or don't. Really what this book is about is those 9 ways that women can change how we think about power. And what I've done is I've provided some very specific, what I call power tools, to help women actually navigate this new world that we have. We're in the middle of an unfinished revolution. There are things that are still chaotic, and men and women are trying to figure it out. I interviewed many, many dozens of incredible women. Their inspiring stories are in the book. And I did a lot of research as well. I also have a lot of my own experience. You know, I've had 40 years of experience on the front line of activism for women. So a lot of my own lessons are in there too. I want to help women figure out what to do in this next phase.
All right. Gloria, it's always a pleasure.
Likewise.
Good to see you. Thank you so much for joining us. And good luck with the book.
Thank you so much, Dad.
All right.